Don't forget laundry pickup today, laundry drop off today, and I think that's it. We got some cakes. They don't see any birthday people here. We're celebrating Jennifer's birthday, and we're celebrating. They've been coming a little late, so Jennifer gets here, we'll celebrate her birthday. We got some 7-Up cake. I'm just telling you, it's some good stuff. And then there's somebody else. Oh, Casey. Y'all, I didn't see Casey at Bible study. Maybe. Yeah, you did, but I don't have it in front of me. Y'all come join us. Hey, I know that shirt. Come on, y'all. Come get us. Woo-hoo! My check. Mic check. There you go. And if Timothy shows up during service later, y'all don't let me forget to give him his baptism certificate from next week. And Mr. Timothy if you want to be baptized, okay, hear me, if you want to be baptized, there's a list over there. You write your name on it and what size clothes you wear. And then next week when we do baptisms, not only will we bring you a towel, we'll bring you a set of dry clothes. I'll take your wet clothes home with me, wash them, and bring you back the next week. It's a great system. So, probably not doing baptisms this week, I don't think. We had a couple people potentially, but I don't see them here yet. So, that's the story so far.
The birthday list is up there too.
And the birthday list. Don't forget us on the birthday list. And you put on there, okay, my name is Mary, and my birthday's in December, and I like strawberry cake, because it's pink. So, you write your name, your birthday, and you don't have to write your last name, but put at least your last initial, because we've got more than one of some folks, and then what kind of cake you like, and then we'll have cake or cupcakes, and celebrate your birthday. Anybody like to celebrate their birthday?
Yep.
I'm saying. God is good
all the time.
And all the time,
God is good.
Come on, y'all. Let's get it going in the right direction. I'm just saying. Yeah. All right. Anybody ready to get some Jesus today?
Woo!
Anybody ready to worship the King?
Yeah.
Yes. Come on. I'm excited about the Word today.
Yes.
I'm really excited about the Word today. Jessica and I prayed right before service over there, and she thanked God for His faithfulness to us. And I was like, you don't know how much that fits in with today's message, I do believe, unless He changes it between now and then. God is faithful, y'all. He is on the throne. Jesus is on the mercy seat. And both are eternally faithful to us. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
All right. Father, we just praise you and thank you for today. We blow that shofar on purpose to let the world around us know that this place right here is reserved for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. It is for the Father to get glory while we are here gathered together as a tribe and a family in the ecclesia. We are here because you made us in your image, and we're here to look more like you when we walk away. So we're going to worship you with all our hearts. We're going to worship you in word, in song, in a scripture word from you, while we eat, while we fellowship together. Everything we're doing today is worshiping you and bringing glory, because you are so worthy to be praised. There are not human words to explain how grateful we are for what you have done for us, to us, that you have changed us, that you've given us a new heart, that you have been patient with us when we were prodigals and coming home, that you have been patient with us while we slow leap the change. Come on. Why do we slow leap the change, Lord? Help us. And we're going to worship and sing with all our might in Jesus' name. Amen. Y'all stand up. Let's worship. Sit down. She's going to read something, and then we're going to stand up and worship. My bad.
All right. Can y'all hear me?
Simon says.
All right, so I'm going to read a poem to y'all that I wrote when God first rescued me from me.
Yeah.
All right, it's called Always There, My Testimony from Darkness to Light. I went through most of my life saying, I hate this, it's not fair, feeling like no one truly cared. Little did I know you were always there. We sang Jesus loves me, but the evidence was rare. I used to think, yeah, right, I can't find this love. Somebody tell me where. I didn't know how to turn to you, so I found evil instead. With the devil is where I made my restless, hopeless bed. He told me lie after lie about your love and about my worth. He told me you didn't want me and that you never intended for my birth. Satan gave me money, drugs, and sex to remedy the pain. But all it did was cause me to lose everything and to go insane. Along the way, many of your people planted seeds of your goodness in my life. But Satan kept lying to me, telling me that I could never be good enough to be your wife. Some way, somehow, you found me in my mess. Some way, somehow, you found me in my mess. And you told me that you and the Father only desired to give me rest. My attachment to familiar spirits made it hard to see who I was in you. But every time I fell short, you picked me up and you showed me what to do. I rebelled often and seldomly listened, and my pride took me my own way. But when I was finally beat down enough and ready, you smiled, took my hand, and said, today is a new day. The blessings started coming in, and from my flesh I was getting free. But I failed to stay in your word, so I wasn't able to be that Psalms 1 tree. My armor and prayer life was not secure, so when Satan came for me, I could not endure. I fell back into drugs and homelessness again, but unlike most, you were still my best friend. I knew that you were my only way out, and for the first time, I had more faith than I had doubt. I remember thanking you for freedom while I was still in chains. I remember knowing that you loved me dearly, no matter what I put in my veins. I would walk around singing, not by power, but by your spirit, God, send your spirit. And even though everyone around me doubted it, I knew for a fact that you could hear it. On January 30th, I overdosed, and Satan thought he had won. But the truth of the matter is his ruling in my life was finally done. Sweet Jesus, as I lay there dead, I thought I was only asleep. And I was, because you were performing surgery, cleansing me from unclean spirits that were rooted in me deep. When you were done with the operation, you breathed your spirit of life back into me. It was a miracle, a resurrection. I was blind, but now I see. All of a sudden, your power rested in me and upon me. You filled me so full, I had no choice but to walk away free. It's so clear how faithfully awesome you are and determined you are to gather your sheep. I know for a fact that every promise you make, you are sure to keep. You are now the anchor of my soul, my everything, my Lord, my friend. You've made me whole. You turned my brokenness to beauty, and you gave me a joy and a peace that most can't comprehend. I want nothing more than to serve you, and you gave me a new beginning where there appeared to be an end. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Father God, and Holy Spirit, too. I'm so honored and grateful to be redeemed and used by you.
Amen. Amen.
be like you.
Take my cross and follow after you.
I wanna be like you.
Everything I do.
I wanna be like you.
Leave the many to go and find a few.
I wanna be like you.
I am falling in love with you. I am falling in love with you. I am falling in love with you. I am falling in love with you.
us. Amen.
Yeah.
Today we're going to be reading a lot, and that's kind of different for me because I bounce all over and say about 75 scriptures a single message, but we may not really even sometimes open our textbooks, but we're opening our textbooks today. I hope you brought yours with you to Hebrews 11. So I've been thinking about just where we are. Our community, where we are, okay? Where are we? We have seen, we've been down here 8 years. Our church is 14 years old. First 3 years we did recovery in a storefront building, ministering to recovering people, which was easy. I'm recovering. I know what it's like to walk that walk and get free from it. Then we spent the next 3 years in a bigger building. God called us to open a men's halfway house for men getting out of prison in our church. We had an 8-bunk dorm in our church. We had grown and grown and grown in our storefront building to where we rented the space next to us, and we were contemplating renting the space next to that. 120 people, 60, 70 adults, 50 kids. Not everybody was hit on a halfway house. So we lost about two-thirds of our people. Because, man, getting out of prison, I'm like, what? I'm pretty sure you hadn't read the book where Jesus said, man, if you have hated in your heart, you have murdered somebody. If you have lusted in your heart, you've committed adultery. Jesus took it to a whole new level. He took it to a whole new level, and the Pharisees weren't happy with it. But if he hadn't taken it to that whole new level, our lives wouldn't be changed today.
Amen.
So they wanted to sell that building, and we were getting out of it. That's not us. We didn't need to own a building. That's not who God called us to be. Not that there's anything wrong with owning a building, but that wasn't us. And so we found ourselves just church hopping like the original church. We went house to house to house to house, having church from house to house to house to house. And we came down on Thanksgiving Day, I guess it'll be 9 years this year, on Thanksgiving Day. And we had 100 sack lunches and 100 care packages. That's what we called them. We didn't know what to call them. It was new to us. We were just being obedient to the Lord. You know what that's like? You just be obedient to the Lord, no matter how crazy it sounds. You just be obedient to the Lord.
Come on.
Because sometimes, just talking about being crazy and obedient, he calls you to step out of the boat.
Yes, ma'am.
Walk on water to him.
Yes, ma'am.
Sometimes he tells you to come over here and lay on top of somebody dead and they're going to come back to life. Okay, that's crazy, y'all. Until she comes back to life.
Come on.
And so then he said, I was talking to a guy downtown, and he said, man, where is your church? Because I could really listen to you. I said, oh, we're a homeless church. And then Holy Spirit profoundly said, I'm surprised others didn't hear it. And now you're going to minister to the homeless community. I was like, well, score. Homeless church, homeless community, far out. So I took that message back to the community, the church that we had at the time, and we lost everybody but 12 people. And of those 12 people, we have one left. Stand up, Evelyn. Don't give Evelyn a hand.
Yeah.
Come on, Evelyn. Woo! Sister and I have been together for darn near 20 years. In the church before where I was on staff, singles and recovery, all the way through this. But I went home and I told my husband first, because that's the thing to do. See, at church, I'm the pastor and I'm the head of the church. The buck stops with me when we stand before the King.
Amen. Okay?
Whatever happens in all the years that United Bible Community has been rolling, I have to give an account for it. But at home, my husband is the head of the house. And so at home, as talking from wife to husband, we talked about it husband and wife. And he said, well, because we're very different. I think I said this last week too. He said, well, let's find out what permits we need. Let's find out how we get authorization. I said, oh, heck no, we're just going to show it, figure it out. And that's what we did. We came down on Thanksgiving Day. We had our first service a week or two before Christmas. And we met at Panther Island down there. And the rest is history. I mean, I cannot imagine God calling the United Bible Community to do anything anytime soon. Where am I going to go? What Peter said. Peter said in John 6:68, we actually talked about it in Bible study yesterday a little bit. Jesus had just given his famous sermon, eat my body and drink my blood. And everybody was like, ah. And everybody left. Just like when I said, we're going to have a halfway house. Most people left. I said, we're going to go downtown and we're going to do homeless. Everybody left. So Darin and I decided at that point, though none go with me, still I will follow, because he knew I heard right. He trusted me hearing from the Lord. And so we've always said, if we have to go downtown and I preach to him and he does worship for me, so be it. But we've never had an empty Saturday, ever. And it all started because we had faith. Faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the word of God. By faith is that we confess with our mouth, that we believe in our heart, that Jesus is Lord, and we are saved by that. Remember sozo? Not just saved. Saved seems so simple, okay? Not if you're the one drowning, but saved seems simple. However, sozo is big. We are saved. He healed, delivered, kept safe and sound, and made whole. See, we're not whole and we're broken as orphans. Even if we're believers and we go to church, if we're living like an orphan, we hadn't got the whole package deal yet, y'all. We have got the tester package. We're just testing the water for Christianity. It's not until you leave this orphan life and get sold out. Sometimes we got to die to do that. Right. Sometimes we got to die to do that. Mm. And then Jesus brings us back to life.
Come on.
But we have to get to the bottom of the pit in order for Him to reach down and pick us up and set our feet on solid ground and clean us off. And then just like with the prodigal, He says, how about a ring?
Woo-hoo!
How about we have a party? Because my kid has come home. So y'all, we've been down here almost 9 years. We have tilled the ground. We have pulled up the weeds. We have fertilized the soil. We have tilled it some more. We have taken seeds and we have cut them and soaked them in water, preparing them to plant, because some seeds have real tough shells. That's us, y'all. Tough as nails. It's hard out here. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
It is hard out here. Even if you have a roof, it's hard out here without a roof. But it's not impossible to walk with the Lord as a light in the darkness and completely and wholly as a child of God without a roof.
Amen.
Come on, y'all. So in Hebrews 11, well, let me read you this little thing. This was part of my study and one of the things that I was reading this week. But first of all, on your sheet, you have a quote. Remember? You got a quote. It says, God's plan for your life far exceeded the circumstances of your day.
Amen.
That's us, y'all.
Amen.
His plan for your life super exceeds, far exceeds, out of this earth, over the top, whatever circumstance you've got for today. Tell me. I don't care what circumstance you come up with. I promise you I got an answer from the Word of God that super exceeds and carries you out of this, but may not carry you out of this. Come on, that was good, y'all.
Yeah.
It's going to carry you out of it, but He may not carry you out of it yet.
Yeah.
What if you have a job to do?
Hey.
What if you got a campmate that's destined for hell?
Come on, that's good.
Come on, that's good
word. And until you preach the gospel to him, God can't move you over here because he has a job for you.
Come on, Pastor.
And we get through this all by faith. Y'all say faith.
Faith.
It's by faith. This whole chapter 11 in Hebrews, whole chapter. I didn't read what I was going to say. The perfect example of faith is running. Now see, somebody on the other side of the scenes wrote this. 42.195 kilometers. Let me just tell you what that is in English for us. Ready? 22.2 miles.
Oh, that's 10 numbers.
No.
22.22 miles. Y'all, I'm not running a mile. I darn sure not running 22 miles. I don't care who's facing. If it's a bear, he's just going to have to eat me.
Amen.
Saying. The perfect example of faith is running 22.2 miles. Is a staggering challenge for most of us. When runners are at their weariest at the last leg of a marathon, how do they find the strength to finish the race? I said, oh, that's us. How do we get to the place that we find the strength to finish the race? Anybody tired? Anybody worn out?
Hey.
Anybody weary?
Hey.
Anybody exhausted? Anybody burdened? Anybody laden down? I'm telling you, Matthew 11's got an answer for that one. He says, take my yoke, Jesus says, take my yoke upon you, because my yoke is easy. My burden is light. And we stop there. Let's go on and talk about the rest of it. He says, and learn from me.
Come on, that part.
Don't get
that
it? Part. He went all the way to the cross for us. And learn from me. We're going to switch yokes, and this is easier. Okay, it's easier being a son and a daughter than it is being an orphan. But it doesn't take away the persecution. It doesn't take away the struggles. He says, in this world, you will have trouble. But take heart, because I've already overcome the world. Yeah, we already won. Every struggle we go through, remember James 1? We're either in a trial, getting ready to go into one, or just come out of one, and we count it all joy, with or without a roof. All joy, because there's a purpose for it, and in that purpose, it develops our character, and it develops our perseverance. And when, there's another one, too. I don't remember what it is right now, but what it produces?
Endurance.
Oh, endurance. And then, we're perfect and complete, lacking defects. Okay, I'm not perfect, but I am holy. I am not perfect, but I am holy. And I'm going to live every day as holy so that every day God's words can come out of my mouth, no matter where I go, no matter who I see, even if they don't like me. I don't have a problem with people who don't like me. So, sometimes there's a really long line of people that don't like me. Get in line. And I'm just going to hug and kiss each one of you as I go down the line. Because love never fails. You with me? Love never fails. It doesn't give up on people. It doesn't just give up and walk away. It's patient. It's kind. Then we throw in all that fruit of the Spirit. We got love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and selflessness and faith and faithfulness and self-control. But you know what I mean? You take all of that and you put it all together and you get your suitcase full of all of that, it's way different than carrying the baggage of life that we used to carry.
Amen.
That baggage that we used to carry, I carried all my addictions with me. I carried all my pain of the past. I carried all my scars from trauma. I carried all my hurts and sorrows from walking away from the Lord and not raising my children for 14 years in that. I carried all that baggage, all that depression, all that anxiety, and all of that. And y'all, I just barely drug through in life. Till I got to the bottom. Till I got to the very stinking bottom. I said, I'm either checking out or I'm going home. And so since Jesus was my only option, because I couldn't check out, y'all heard this before, some of you, I had kids I had to raise, Jesus was my only option. And when I went running back to Jesus with my speech already made, right? I'm so sorry, Lord, I didn't mean to leave you. I don't know why I walked away. I didn't know what I was doing. Nobody told me to leave and not take you with me. I didn't have a chance. He gave me one of them giggle bugs. And a ring and a rope. Yes. Because my child has come home. So we have tilled the ground and we have got things ready. We pulled up the weeds and we've cut the seeds and we've soaked them in water. And now we're seeing fruit almost 9 years later. We've had 21 people be baptized.
Hey!
Okay, now the water's not miraculous. As a matter of fact, it's pretty nasty and dirty. But it is the Trinity, come on, hey, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It is the Trinity River we're getting it in, but that water is not special. It's the proclamation that Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Savior of my life. He is Lord of my life. A lot of people want Jesus as Savior. Ain't nobody, not everybody wants Him as Lord.
Okay.
Savior's good. It's the fire insurance. You know, get out of hell free. Okay, it's the fire insurance. The Savior part is. The Lord, that's when we win.
Good word,
that is when we win. That's when we let go of everything. All that baggage I was talking about that carried me and weighted me down and went with me in life. And then when I traded all that baggage for the yoke of Jesus Christ,
come on.
Oh, so much easier. And Paul says, won't you be a little crazy with me? Let's be a little crazy for the cause of Christ. Let's do a little dance for the joy within us that comes from having faith in somebody that's faithful and true. Never once did he turn his back on me. Not once. I can see all the times that he carried me through that I didn't even talk to him for 14 years. How can he use somebody like me? How on earth can he call me to be a shepherd? How can he call me to be a pastor? Don't you know where I've been? Don't you know what I've done? Don't you know how many times I've been married? Don't you know I have tattoos? Don't you know I have pink hair? He said, yeah, I know everything. I know it all. Remember, I'm all-knowing. It was actually my husband who had to convince me, because I was convinced by my religious upbringing that women can't be pastors.
Oh, come on.
My husband said, find that in the Word. I think you need to go back and look. Remember, that's the husband I prayed for. That's the husband that he gave me. The one that I could follow, as he loved Jesus more than me, and I could follow him. Come on.
It's not in there.
It's not in there. And there's more women in there than you can imagine. We just aren't taught that in Western culture, America.
Come on.
So, I think that was all of a commercial, because we are, oh, I was going to read this. Did I finish reading it? Okay. How are we going to finish the race at the very last of it? It's a staggering challenge for us. So some say the cheers of the sideline supporters energizes people. Don't you get energized when we come together as the ecclesia?
Yeah.
We come together to build one another up and encourage one another, spur one another on. I am exhausted by the time I am on the way home. I know when it's been a super good service, when I can't get it up to the speed limit, and I got to get it up to the speed limit and push cruise control, because I'm just so tired I'm driving 15 under. But I am so energized that I am exhausted, but I lay in bed stoked.
Yeah.
Just beside myself. God, you showed up today in a mighty way. He's been showing up for these messages for weeks now, y'all. Weeks.
Yeah.
Not that he hasn't always showed up. Because I don't prepare anything. It's my relationship with him that I open my mouth and he begins to speak. Remember, we don't read this. We what? We become it. We live it. We're not supposed to read the Bible. We're supposed to be the Bible. We're supposed to be just like Jesus.
Amen.
And so maybe it's the cheerers, the people that cheer as they're running by. Yeah, you can do it. Or maybe it's the importance of having your eyes fixed on that goal.
Focus.
The end point, the prize, that finish line. Man, if I can just make this just a little while longer. Hey, I know there's a lot in our community that has said, okay, my housing's come in, my number's up, I'm ready. And then it's 3 more months. And I'm like, man, game on. Game on. I'll wait. I know. I can do it. If I've been here this long, I can wait 3 more months. There's an end in sight.
Yeah.
There's an end in sight for all of us sons and daughters. Come on, y'all. It's when the groom comes with his bride. Remember, it's not a rescue out of here, out of this hellhole that we live in. That's not what it is. It's a pickup date for a wedding, and we ought to be dressed ready in all of our fruit of the Spirit, in all of our gifting, in all of the things that we are doing in service for him, because faith without works is dead.
Hey.
Man.
Don't say you have faith and there's no fruit on your tree. If there's nothing to pick off your tree, then we have got to go, Jesus. If we've got to put some little harvesting going on in the tree of your life, so you can start getting some fruit, man, I'll prove the way. Remember, he is the vine dresser. Okay, we're the vine, and he cuts off the dead stuff, and he cuts the stuff growing. You're getting cut either way. What about the storm that comes to the guy that built his house on the rock and the idiot that built his house on the sand? The same storm comes for both of them. In this world, you will have trouble.
Come on.
You're looking at the wrong thing if you're just down and out. That's not it. I mean, I know Texas is hot, but hell's a whole lot hotter, y'all. Not that I'm trying to scare you into heaven, but I'd like to encourage you to be in a relationship with Jesus. It's freedom, y'all.
Yeah.
It's complete freedom. None of this nonsense where, oh, yeah, I'm saved. I'm saved. Whatever, man. You're not all the way saved. You're slow licking the change, y'all. I told you I slow lick the change. And I don't advise it. Because once I got the other side and I was full on a daughter to the King of Kings, I have nothing to do with my old self. She is so dead and gone. It's so dead and gone. Dust. There is nothing in my old life that I want back. You hear me? Nothing. While we may not run sporting marathons, there's a lot of parallels in the lasting and finishing the marathon of our Christian journey. Paul talks about it. We talked about it first. Hebrews 11. Now, faith, I'm in the Passion Translation. Y'all know me. Brings our hopes into reality and becomes the foundation needed to acquire the things we long for. I could stop right there and preach just on that one sentence. Now, faith. Can I say now faith?
Now faith.
Brings our hopes into reality and becomes the foundation needed to acquire the things we long for. Hold on. It may be a bumpy ride, but you're going to get it. It's coming. Don't be at the airport when your train comes in. Seriously, that's how we miss our blessings. We're doing our will, hanging out at the airport, and Jesus says, whoop, whoop. And we're not there. Somebody else is going to get it. You missed it. That just stinks. Where are you going to go today, Father? Oh, the train station? I'm down. And then my train comes in. With me?
Yep.
This testimony of faith is what previous generations were commended for. Faith empowers us to see that the universe was created and beautifully coordinated by the power of God's Word. Remember, life and death is then
the power of the tongue.
We can either speak life or we can speak death. We can build people up or we can tear them down. We can speak things into existence or we can partner with sickness and stay there.
Oh, no.
No.
Life and death.
That's not who we are.
Mm-hmm.
Faith empowers us to see that the universe was created beautifully, coordinated by the power of God's words. He spoke and the invisible realm gave birth to all that is seen. I told y'all 1,000 times, I saw it in my vision. I saw the Father, okay? And with the Ruach, his breath, you know how when you breathe, your lungs expand? With the Ruach. And then when he opened his mouth and said, let there be light, that was Jesus, the Word. The words that were coming out of his mouth was Jesus, Colossians. Everything was created by him, through him, and for him. Let there be light. Oh, that's cool. That's one of the other coolest visions I've ever had, was life entering back into Jesus Christ when he came back from the dead. His lifeless body laying in a tomb, wrapped in a shroud. He has just taken out what has threatened humanity for 4,000 years. Just demolished sin and death. They no longer have reign in our life unless we give it to them. And he conquered, and he came back with the keys, and his lifeless body was laying there, and he said, everything changed.
Right.
That was a game changer. Those two visions are my most favorite visions, and I've had a lot. But here, faith moved Abel to choose a more acceptable sacrifice to offer God than his brother Cain. And God declared him righteous because of his offering of faith. By his faith, Abel still speaks instructions to us today, even though he is long gone. Faith translated Enoch from this life, and he was taken up into heaven. He never had to experience death. He just disappeared from this world because God promoted him.
Come on.
I went on that train.
Right.
Me too.
Not that I'm getting on it. I'm all right. Appointed once for every man to die. I'm ready to live as Christ and to die as gain. Paul says, man, I'd rather go be with him. I still got some work to do, so I guess I'll stay. But I'd way rather be over there, outside of time. For before he was translated to the heavenly realm, his life had become a pleasure to God. I want God to feel that way about me.
Amen.
I want my life to be a pleasure to him. You with me? This whole chapter, okay, I don't know how far I get. I hope to read the whole thing. I don't know. I don't even know what time it is. You got to read it this week. Remember, don't believe me. Don't believe anything I tell you today. You go read it from here so it's your own word. Chew your own food spiritually. Chew your own food for dinner tonight. faith opened Noah's heart to receive. Did I miss something? And without living faith within us, it would be impossible to please God. For we come to God in faith, knowing that He is real and that He rewards the faith of those who passionately seek Him. Don't come to church to be a Christian. Don't. That's not what it's about. We are the church. We don't even have a building, y'all. So don't come to church to be a Christian. Don't go to McDonald's to be a hamburger. Don't go to the garage to be a truck. Come to church to build one another up, spur one another on, be encouraged, and be in the Word. You should be in the Word 7 days a week. She can come up here. Oh, unless she's going with me. Oh, those are babies. Those are babies playing. Come here. Come here. You with me? Is anybody picking up when I'm laying down?
Hey.
Don't go to church to be a Christian. If you're not in this 7 days a week, you are spiritually starving. Now, I know in our community, there are some times you may go a day without food. Call it fasting then. Okay? You miss the sack lunches at Broadway or whatever. There's nobody else feeding today. All right, take advantage of the time.
Amen. That's good.
Come on. Jesus fasted for 40 days. There's an LCU student when I was there that fasted for 40 days. 40 days. That's his determination. If God called me to do a 40-day fast, I would do it, but He hadn't called me. Starting in verse 7, faith opened Noah's heart to receive revelation and warnings from God about what was coming, even things that had never been seen. But he stepped out in reverent obedience to God and built the ark. He built a boat that would save him and his family. Y'all, this boat is big. I have seen the replica in Kentucky.
Yeah.
It's probably from that bridge to that park bench. Three stories tall. Or maybe four, I can't remember, it's at least three. Darin said, and he knows what he's talking about, that at the front of the boat, he could get on his scooter and hit all four gears and not be at the end of the boat yet. That's a big boat, y'all. That's not going in the Trinity. That's a big boat. Huge. He built a boat for rain that had never happened. No rain had ever fallen from the sky. Dude looked like an idiot. I might have looked a little strange when I came back and said, y'all, we're changing everything in our church. We're changing everything. God trained us in recovery. He trained us in the halfway house. And we're taking all that training. And we're now going to go downtown and sweat like a horrid church. Y'all, that was supposed to be last. Come on, y'all, on Nickel Sunday. You have that part? Sweat like a horrid church on Nickel Sunday. That's what I said. Yes, I said it.
She said it.
It's hot out here. What's freezing? Sometimes we have to shorten the message. Sometimes Darin has to shorten the worship. He can maybe only play one song because he can't feel his lips anymore and his fingers are numb. But we will be here. Rain or shine, snow or hail or whatever. We have always been here. One time we couldn't come because in an ice apocalypse a few years ago, we couldn't even get out. But before it froze solid, we made sure everybody in our community had a place to be. We knocked on church doors and we got people inside. We went under bridges looking for people to be sure they were inside before we got froze and couldn't come back out. We did not take care of our tribe. Jesus did not take care of his people. You with me? By faith. By his faith, the world was condemned, but Noah received God's gift of righteousness that comes by believing. Verse 8, faith motivated Abraham to obey God's call and leave the familiar to discover the territory he was destined to inherit from God. God said, pack your stuff, we're going. And he said, to where? And he said, that way, just follow me. So Abraham just went. To a land his people had never been at before, he probably didn't speak the language. And he showed up and he stayed. Because that's what God said to do. but then God honored that. He honored his faithfulness, that he just went to a land that was far away from everything he knew. It didn't even have the same livestock that he knew how to take care of. You with me? It was all kinds of different. I mean, I'm amazed when folks come here and they say they're from somewhere. Well, how'd you get here? I don't know. I just came here. Oh, I think he was right here. To this tribe, to this flock. You got to be in a tribe. You got to be in a flock. Are them lions that are out there that roam around roaring, that want to steal, kill, and destroy, will eat you for lunch. That's why you need a tribe. With or without a root, y'all. You with me?
Yeah.
What I want you to know, and what I want you to see, because besides Abraham, he has his wife, Sarah. Bless her heart. Y'all, they were as old as dirt. He was 100. She was 90. And she gave birth to the promise that God had given them. Y'all, I'm 60 and I don't want to have a baby. I can't imagine being 90 and having a baby. And that's exactly what she did when an angel told her. She laughed. Oh, man. Tell me how that turns out when we laugh in the face of God. I mean, I've done it before. No, I don't think so. You got to be kidding. No, I'm not. Okay. Because I did it once. And it stuck with me for years. Y'all know that story? I was in line going to visit my brother in prison. And it happened to be picture day. And there were 1,000 people there. And it looked like a Six Flags line. Going like this on the inside. Normally you just walk at the door and go up to the thing, give her your ID. They check the files, you're good to go. Then you go get frisked. And then you go to the next checkpoint. And then you go get your assignment and table to sit down. No, I'm doing this thing in Jesus. And this was back when I had just come back to the Lord. I mean, I was pretty new at it. He said, see that girl over there? He highlighted her like there was nobody else in the room. Go tell her I love her. Go tell her Jesus loves you. Oh, Lord, she's so far away. There's 5 lines between us and her. I can't even yell across the room. We're moving around. Now I can't even see her. And I'm like, God said, go tell her Jesus loves her. Okay, well, you know, I'm not really near her. And, you know, the line keeps moving up. And it's going on. And then she still went over there. Yeah, by the time she checked out to leave, my spanking hurt so hard. Jesus said, I needed her to know today that I loved her. Sorry, Lord. When I get in the room, because it was my brother, we could sit across the table. We were not on telephones. When I get in the room, I will find her and I will go tell her, even though that is way against the rules. Y'all, she wasn't in there. I cried 2.5 hours home because I let my daddy. And I said, Lord, give me another chance. Please, give me another chance. 5 years before he asked me to do that again. Don't think that lesson, it was a mistake that turned into a lesson, but we're talking 20 years later now, or plus, I hadn't forgotten it. So when Jesus says, go tell that person, yeah, but he's got an AK-47 or whatever they're called in his hands and he's shooting them. Go tell him. I will go tell him. What's he going to do to me? Send me home? Deuces. Remember, I'm already eternal. I'm not just human. I am an eternal being. The Lamb's Book of Life has got my name in it. I'm seated in the heavenlies. I'm eternal. For real. We were down here maybe a year, and I made somebody really mad. Really, really, really mad. And he was going to kill me. He put the word out. He was going to kill me. His dad told me he's crazy. And he said, you won't know when or where, but you will know it's me. Okay. Did it stop me from coming? Nope. Did it stop me from showing up every Saturday? At that time, we were coming like 4 times a week. We were down here like 5 times a week back then. People were still sleeping around the jail and around the courthouse. It was a stocked fishing tank. fishing for people. It was amazing. It didn't happen. I'd be okay with it. Because by faith, I am living my life. By faith. Because see, all these people that are listed in here, okay, so Abel, he was murdered, y'all. Noah, he was a drunk. Abraham, he was a cheater. We got Sarah, his wife, because by faith, she experienced the miracle working wonder of God to have a baby at 90. But she laughed at God. She was filled with doubt. Verse 13, these heroes all died still clinging to their faith, not even receiving all that had been promised. God told me a long time ago, I'm a seed planter, and I may not see fruit from the seeds that I plant. I'm all right with that. We've had one in a row of all the years, with one in a row in the halfway house of the numerous people that came through. We had a guy that came in mid-December. He thought I was retarded and this nonsense of following Jesus was crazy. And he left first part of January. And by February, he caught 99 to life in Denton County. I said, oh, you should have listened to me. I just need one in a row. We got one in a row. We got two in a row. We got 21 in a row, y'all. Because that's how my God works. I don't have to keep coming if no fruit shows. I know what I'm doing is right, because he told me what to do, and by faith, I have listened and obeyed.
Come on.
Trust and obey. It's faith that's going to carry us through, y'all. I don't care what circumstance you're in, with or without a roof, code compliance or no code compliance. I don't care what kind of charges you've got you're afraid to go to court with. I'll go with you. We'll pray before we go in. I have seen miracles happen, because Jesus shows up in the courtroom too, y'all. Because he's going to show up in the eternal courtroom. And when we stand before the eternal judge, he's going to go, oh, hey, Dad, this one's ours. Come on, follow me up here. Because I got the best defense attorney ever created. The human side of Jesus. He wasn't created. Jesus is always dead. Do you know what I mean? These heroes all died still clinging to their faith, not even receiving all that had been promised. But they saw beyond the horizon the fulfillment of their promises and gladly embraced it from afar. Jesus said, you may not see fruit. I said, I don't care if I see fruit. I'm going to plant. I'm going to plant. I'm going to plant. I'm going to plant. I'm going to water. I'm going to plant. I'm going to plant. I'm going to show up, whether I feel like it or not some days.
Come on.
By faith. And I'm going to see from afar. Y'all know my greatest gift that I feel that I have is being able to see you the way Jesus sees. I don't see what the world sees. I see what the heavenlies see. I love that gift. I mean, I got the gift of talking. I really don't need a microphone. I got a pretty big mouth and a large set of lungs that God gave me from the time I was born that my mother was very opposed to. But now I know why. Somebody's got to bring the word loud enough. When we were over at Gethsemane, they used to tell me all the time, we can hear you at 7-Eleven. We don't have to come to church. We're having church there in the 7-Eleven parking lot. That's 2 blocks away, y'all. I didn't even have a microphone yet. Don't you want on the team? Doesn't this team sound amazing?
Amen.
Oh, from afar, I can see. I can see what that front looks like. I can see what my daddy says is there. Y'all read Isaiah's account. Y'all read John the Revelator's account. They all live their lives on earth as those, hear me, who belong to another realm. They live their lives on earth as those who belong to another realm. That's it, y'all. It's on and popping with that. This isn't it. It's there. Remember we're running that race, keeping our eyes on the prize ahead? It's all there. Every last bit of it. Every single promise from here to there is ours if you're a son and daughter. She's a daughter. For clearly, verse 14, Those who live this way are longing for the appearance of a heavenly city. And if their hearts were still remembering what they left behind, they would have found an opportunity to go back. Y'all hear me? I'm reading that again. Chop, chop. Look up here and listen. We're living for the heavenly city. But if their hearts were still remembering what they left behind, they would have found an opportunity to go back. Sodom and Gomorrah. Lot's wife. Just one look. Y'all, there is nothing in our past that's worth keeping. None of it. Not an ounce of it. Nothing without Jesus has any value at all. But if it's still in your heart, you're going to go back. Y'all, I pray mean prayers. I pray mean prayers. I pray freeing prayers. Go ahead, use one more time. I dare you. I pray you get so violently sick, you don't think you can throw up anything else, and you can't go to the bathroom one more time, and your fever is out of here, you need in a bed of ice. Try it. Try me. Ask me to pray for you. It sets people free. Because it gets you to that bottom so that you can come up. Stop digging if you're in a hole. For Pete's sake, stop digging. That can be your bottom right there. You don't have to get lower. Come on, let's get free. You with me? God's changing you, Michael. I can see it. That's awesome. I mean, just want to pull you out. But brother got baptized.
Yeah.
Awesome. But you know what happens when new believers get baptized? The enemy comes after them. Y'all be praying for our new
Amen.
Don't let the body of Christ down by not continuing to pray for those that have been newly baptized, that have newly proclaimed their faith. Because the enemy doesn't want that. We're pulling people out of hell, y'all. The enemy does not like that at all. He says, wait, that was mine. You can't have mine. Oh, yeah, I did. Hide and watch. But we've got to be praying for them. Don't go back. But they couldn't turn back, for their hearts were fixed on what was far greater, that is, the heavenly realm. Say amen.
Amen.
We're not. There's nothing. It's all the race ahead of us. So because of this, God is not ashamed in any way to be called their God, for he has prepared a heavenly city. God's not ashamed to call you his. At all. I'm not ashamed to call you part of this flock. At all. I don't care who you are or what you've done or what you are doing. That's not who you are. Because when the sun sets free, it's free indeed. Jesus is the freedom that we need. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And ain't nobody getting to the Father except through him. There is no other way. Jesus is the only way. And we're to become like him, so that we can walk around on this earth as ambassadors to the kingdom, so that when people see us, they're like, man, what do you got? You're always smiling. You always got love. You always got giggle hugs. Them hugs that just knock you down, they'll be old coffee this next time.
Right.
She's coming at you with a giggle hug from Jesus.
There she is.
That is off the chain, y'all.
Yeah.
There is so much love that flows through this church right here. It's astounding to me. Now, I know y'all fight during the week. Don't think I'm not an idiot. Y'all can't run game on God, and you can't run game on this pastor here. Okay? I'm telling you, a con knows a con. An alcoholic knows an alcoholic. A drug addict knows a drug addict.
Yeah.
A deliverer from all of that really can see it. Because I'm not in it no more. Don't you want to be like this? Paul says, hey, follow me till you can walk on your own. Because I'm following Jesus every step of the way. And love is what runs through this church. I don't care what your sin is. I don't need to know what your sin is. That's between you and Jesus. What I care about is the love that you feel while you're here that comes from above. Oh, that was good. That's what I care about. You with me?
Amen.
Because we are united on the Bible, and it makes us a community.
Amen.
That's how we got our name. God gave us our name. We didn't want to be First Church of something, something. And we certainly aren't any denomination. And we're not a no denomination. And we're not Seventh-day Adventists because we meet on Saturday. We meet on Saturday because it's the Sabbath and it didn't change in the Word. Look it up. Mm-hmm. Now, it's not a deal breaker if you go to church on Sunday. There are some things that are a deal breaker. That was not one of them.
Amen?
Amen.
You've got to know that these people, by faith. Then he goes on to talk about Abraham, and then he's got his son Isaac, and he's got Jacob. And then we're going on, I mean, the next generation. Going on. And then, I mean, it's just out of there, y'all. Look at this. If you turn, look, see how much I got written on in my book? Okay, look. Esau, first we got Jacob, he's a trickster. He conned his father into getting the birthright. And then Jacob, I mean, Esau, dude, sold his birthright for a bowl of beans. That's some pretty hungry. What about Joseph? By faith, he did all kinds of stuff. But you know what? His brothers sold him into slavery after they dumped him in the pit. They were picked up by gypsies and sold to the Muslims that tried to pick him up. And then he ended up in Potiphar's house, and everything was hunky-dory till Mrs. Potiphar had a thing for him and took him and said, oh, you were my foster wife. I don't think so. And she hollered, and he ended up in prison for years. Something he didn't do. But by faith, Joseph stood his ground. What about Daniel? It's by faith that the lions didn't eat him. What about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? It's by faith they walked into that fire. Because the guards died before they got there. How do you think they got in there? Guards died because the fire was so hot. And so I'm stepping in. Because I got faith. Where's your faith today? We got Moses, bless his heart. He was a basket case, y'all. And a murderer. Let me get Rahab. We're talking about a hooker, y'all. She was a prostitute. But she was also Jesus' great, 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 great grandmother. Oh, commercial. I found out today I'm going to be a great grandmother. Lacey. I got to do their wedding December the 31st out here in Sundance Square. Was it December 31st? December 30th. We practiced the Christmas thing, and then we all went over there, and she changed into a wedding dress, and changed into some fancy clothes with his camo Crocs, which is pretty funny looking. And we did a wedding in the whole entire Sundance Square watch. And she found out this early this morning in the ER that she couldn't stop throwing up, that she pushed out.
Come on.
I'm going to be a great grandmother.
Woo!
I'm telling you. Go, Jesus. And then you've got Gideon. He was a chicken, y'all. He was hiding from everybody. You got David. He was a cheater and a murderer. You got Samson, man. His eyes were wandering. It was faith that shut the mouth of lions, put out the power of a raging fire, and caused many to escape certain death by the sword. Although weak, their faith imparted power to make them strong. Now, I'm going to read the rest of this, and y'all can look, please, with me. Starting in verse 34. I already read that part. Faith sparked courage within them, and they became mighty warriors in battle, pulling armies from other realms into battle array. Yo, we pray for the angel armies around here today. We don't want any interruptions. We want people set free today. That's battling people in the other realm. They're real, in case you didn't know. They're big, they're mighty, in case you know. Faith-filled women saw their dead children raised in resurrection power. Yet it was faith that enabled others to endure great atrocities. Now hear me. This doesn't happen in America yet. It happens all over the rest of the world, thousands daily. It started here when the church began. It's coming. Your faith better be so solid, rock solid in Jesus Christ, that when they put a guillotine out here, one of them things that stretches you to the top, not like Stretch Armstrong, you better be able to go, Jesus is my Lord and Savior, and I don't bow to anybody else but Jesus Christ and the God of the universe. Do whatever you need to. I'm standing on solid ground because He's my Savior and my Lord. They were stretched out on a wheel and tortured and didn't deny their faith in order to be free because they longed for a more honorable and glorious resurrection. Others were mocked and experienced the most severe beatings with whips. They were in chains and imprisoned. Some of these faith champions were brutally killed by stoning, being sawed in two, or slaughtered by the sword. These lived in faith as they went about wearing goatskins and sheepskins for clothing. They lost everything they possessed. They endured great afflictions, and they were cruelly mistreated. They wandered the earth, living in the desert wilderness, in caves, on barren mountains, and in holes, and in the earth. Truly, the world was not even worthy of them, not realizing who they were. That's who I want to be. Right there. It's coming. It's coming. And we all need to be awake and on guard. Paul says in Ephesians 6, be on guard. You know how you get shot when you take your shield of faith? Because how many darts of the devil does it extinguish? All of them is how you get shot. So put your shield of faith down and look over it. No matter what's going on that side. This stops all of them. Faith. By faith, that's how we walk. By faith, that's how we live. By faith, that's how we endure. By faith, that's how we persevere. By faith, that's how we're going to finish the race. Y'all see anything here today? Mm. By faith. Because it's going to get nasty. It's not nasty yet. But I'm going to preach to you're so rock solid that when it gets nasty, we got a whole tribe standing up for Jesus Christ.
Come on.
You with me? There's no other way to God. Lots of people believe in God. Whatever. Who is their God? It's got a big G or a little G. If it's got a big G, it's got Jesus Christ as his son. All the rest of them got a little G. Lots of people worship little gods. My God is the one to worship. You know what I'm saying? These were the true heroes, commended for their faith, yet they lived in hope without receiving the fullness of what was promised to them. It doesn't matter if it comes this side of time, it's going to come that side of time. Honestly, I don't want it this side of time. Because that side of time's payoff is 2-1, or whatever. You know what I mean? That was for all of our gambling addicts people here. 2-1. Jesus, come on. The payoff's better on the other side. I don't want to get paid here. If I get paid here, I don't get paid there. We're living out loud in faith for the other side of time to come. With me? But now God has invited us to live in something better than what they had. Ready? Faith's fullness. Now they didn't have faith's fullness because Jesus hadn't come yet. Jesus has now come. He did the deal changer. He did the deal breaker. He closed the old covenant. He opened the new one. We are now living in faith's fullness. Ta-da! That's what we want, y'all. This is so that they could be brought to finished perfection along the way. We're a result of them. Y'all, if the disciples had gone into the world and preached the gospel to the ends of the earth, we wouldn't be here. They did that by faith. I'm waiting to change Fort Worth. We don't need a whole lot. We just need a few. Jesus did it with 12. If we're like this, we ought to be able to do it with 12. I know we got 12 here. It's time. Chapter 12. As for us, we have all of these great witnesses who encircle us like clouds. Your version may read that we are surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses. So we must let go of every wound that has pierced us and the sin we so easily fall into. Well, how can we fall into sin and be holy? Oh, it's pretty easy to walk along and step in a hole and not realize it. You just got to step right back out of it and keep going.
Yeah,
don't let it stop you and turn around and look at the old ways. Walk by a needle if you see it on the street. Walk by a little baggie if you see it on the street. You will see lots of them. As soon as you declare that you are done doing drugs, it will be thrown at you, I promise. Anybody testify?
Hey.
See, look. I'm telling you. I'm quitting today. Here's a dime bag.
Yeah.
Snap. Don't. Power of Jesus. By faith we have overcome. By faith we will continue to overcome. By faith it's out of here to there. I got so much more to read. So we must let go of every wound that has pierced us and the sin that we so easily fall into. Then we will be able to run life's marathon race with passion and determination. Don't tell me I can't do something. If it's for Jesus, God, don't tell me. You better move out the way. I will. Refrigerator Perry, plow you down to get to what to do. I'm supposed to be doing. That's for all you old people in here. I think one person knows who Refrigerator, two people know who Refrigerator Perry is. He was a hawk in Dallas Cowboys. That's the stallbox today. That boy could plow a refrigerator down. That's why he was called Refrigerator Perry. With passion and determination for the path that's already been marked out for us. Yo, they showed us exactly how to live. All of them. I don't care what your circumstance is. I promise you there's somebody in here that you can relate to. I can relate to Rahab. I wore a scarlet letter. I can get that. Samson. Okay? We can relate to people in this, and we see how they overcome. And even though they fell short, their faith delivered them. Where's your faith? How big is your faith? You know how much faith? Oh, man, I should have brought that. This would have been perfect. You know how big a mustard seed is? It's like the size of a flea. And if you don't know what that is, it's the size of half an ant. Y'all know what ants are. Tiny. We need faith of a mustard seed. And we can say, mountain, move. We can say, be healed. We can say, be free. Just don't go back to it. If you're free now, don't go back to it. Jesus didn't die on the cross so that you could get free again and again and again and again and again. Now, you can do that, but that's a stupid way to do it. Just get free once. Get free once. Get dunked. Make a proclamation. Live for Jesus and then become like this. Don't go back to your old way. It has no life and no value. Pick that zero. We look away from the natural realm. We focus our attention and expectation onto Jesus, who birthed faith within us. And who leads us forward into faith's perfection. You know how we're going to get there? By faith. You know who's going to lead us? Jesus Christ. You know who's going to empower us? Holy Spirit. You know who can answer your questions if you can't find an answer? Me. If I don't know an answer, I'll find it. I'll be quick to tell you, I don't know, but I'll look it up and I'll tell you. Because every answer is in here. Everything you need for life on how to deal with life is in here. Every word you need to get free is in here. Everything you need to encourage you is in here. Everything you need to know about how to be born again and live in the Spirit and fight a spiritual battle. Y'all get shot because you're fighting a spiritual battle with carnal weapons. Don't take a sword to a gunfight, you will lose. We aren't fighting flesh and blood. You're not fighting homeboy at your camp. He may have stole all your stuff, but your war is not with him. Your war is with the rulers and the authorities and the powers of this dark world and the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realm. Because we ain't fighting flesh and blood. You still want my stuff? Fine, I hope you enjoy it. I don't give you more. The one that gave me what I had, right?
Yeah.
We've got to hold on to the things that are true. You can't let what you see with your eyes determine what you know as truth. Because that enemy will lie to you all day long. Remember, he's the deceiver of all lies. He invented lies. So consider carefully how Jesus faced such intense opposition. Now we're going to get to Jesus. Wait, where's that song? Look away from the natural realm and we focus our attention and expectation onto Jesus, who birthed faith within us and who leads us forward in faith's perfection. His example is this. Because his heart was focused on the joy of knowing that you would be his, he endured the agony of the cross and conquered its humiliation and now sits exalted at the right hand of the throne of God. The worst humiliation that existed was what Jesus went through. And he went through every ounce of it because he loves us. Now, today, 2023 years later, or whatever. That's some pretty awesome stuff. He didn't die on the cross for you. He died on the cross as you. That's why we can say that it's not I that lives, but it's him that lives in me, because I experienced crucifixion. I just wasn't alive to really experience it, because he experienced it for me. You with me? So consider carefully how Jesus faced such intense opposition from sinners who opposed their own souls, so that you won't become worn down and cave in under life's pressure. After all, you've not yet reached the point of sweating blood in your oppositions. Ain't nobody saying no to dope so bad that they're sweating blood. Just keep saying no. You just keep saying no, because eventually he's going to stop. Because every time he comes at you, you run to the Father, that's not what he wants. He's running to you to get you off track, to look back and go back to what you used to do. But if he comes at you and tries to get you off track and you run to the Father, oh man, oh snap, that's not what he wanted. And then he's going to come at you this afternoon, and he's going to come at you tomorrow morning, and you're going to run to the Father every stinking single time. And at some point, he gets tired of that. Singing glory, hallelujah, thank you Jesus for this opportunity to deny flesh and live for you. Whatever he's coming at you with, you praise Jesus for the opposite of it out loud. He says, oh, thank you Jesus that I am so full of joy. Thank you Jesus that I have overcome. Thank you Jesus that you have called me your child. Oh, Father, I thank you because you have freed me from my past. And I am free because the Son has set me free, and I am free indeed. Yes. And I'm like a tree planted by the water, and I have a pure, clean heart. Oh, I dropped the feather. Come on. You get it? It's time for us to start living out loud. Where's the fruit on your tree? I want to see it. Have you forgotten his encouraging words spoken to you as his children? Raise your hand if you're a son or a daughter. This is for you. My child, don't underestimate the value of discipline and training of the Lord God. Or get depressed when he has to correct you. For the Lord's training of your life is the evidence of his faithful love. And when he draws you to himself, it proves you are his delightful child. Oh, yeah. And it's us. I get spankings all the time, y'all. If you're not getting spankings, then you're not doing something right. You're not living out loud enough. Because we just stumble over stuff. And somebody comes approach, and I don't even look at him. God said, oh, you missed that. Dang it. I make them walk and go back around. That spanking hurts. I've had a few that really hurt. I got spanked by a coach when I was a senior in high school, the coach of the football team, and I was a sports trainer. I took care of the boo-boos. He was hot. And he had one of them paddles. It had the holes drilled in it. Dang, I couldn't sit down for 2 days. I'm serious. Now, I did what was wrong that I deserved to spank for, which was silly. I should come and chat with y'all. But I've had spankings from Holy Spirit that got like that. Like that girl in prison, in the line to go visit. Tell her, Jesus, how hard is that? It's not like I'm going to see her again. Oh, I will now. I would recognize her if I saw her today. I remember her face. Because that spanking made me cry for 2.5 hours. Because I was so remorseful. And often, God, give me another chance. Call me out and give me another chance, please. That was a long time. Everybody we come in contact with needs to know that Jesus loves them. How many people have you seen today that you did not say Jesus loves you too? Live your faith out loud. out loud. So there's fruit on your tree, so that we can shine bright, so that we can live for Him. Anybody want more of what they already have? Anybody need that? Anybody need Jesus so that they're no longer orphans and sons and daughters? We all need something. Let's stand and put our hands out. We're going to ask God for stuff today. Don't be shy. If you don't want nothing, don't put your hands up. Don't be a faker. But be real. Father, I thank you that you hear our cries. I thank you that you are just and loving and faithful in abundance for us. To clean our hearts, to clean our lives, to do spiritual surgery with or without anesthesia. Do what you need to prune us so that we look like you, Jesus. Father, you are the vine dresser. Prune away, man. I'm the shepherd of this flock. I give you full permission. Sometimes we need sheep haircuts. Yes, Lord. Some of us need to know how much you love them. Show them. Fill their cup, Lord, to overflowing so that they think their hearts are going first. So they can walk away and go, felt the power of the Lord today. Your love is so intense, so magnificent, that when we get the other side of time, we're going to stand in your love like right now we're standing in air. Woo-hoo! Heal us, Lord. You are the healer. Jesus, you took those stripes so that we could be healed. Heal our minds. Demonic influences of bipolar and paranoid schizophrenia and all that nonsense need to go in Jesus' name.
Come on.
Yes.
There is no place in the hearts and the brains and the thinkers of these people that it deserves to be there. Out in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Let us let go of it, though. Let us let go of it. Let us be free from it. It has no value with us at all. I want to think what you think, Jesus, because you think what the Father thinks.
Mm.
So that I look like His kid. Pour into us all of that stuff that you are. All of the fruit of the Spirit. All of the gifts of the Spirit. All of the love of the Father. All of the increase our faith. I don't have a mustard seed. I got a mustard bush or a mustard tree. I got a mustard vineyard. I don't know how they grow, but I got a whole acres and acres of it, because I believe in you, because I know what you did in my life, and I know what you've done in some of the lives of our people. Change us, Lord. Change us. Don't let us linger and tarry in our old life. Rip it off like a nasty band-aid and let it hurt so that we don't go back. Let us feel it. I love it when people are getting clean. I pray that they kick it hard so that they don't ever go back. It's hard when you just get clean and you just walk away from it. It's really easy to go back to that. But if you get clean and you are violently ill for weeks, you'll remember that. But you, Lord, you know, whatever it takes, that's what we want. Your will, not ours, your will. But I am violently passionate about seeing people free and growing up in you. We don't need a whole bunch of baby Christians. We need a whole bunch of growing Christians.
Come on.
Use us, Lord. Pour us out like a drink offering. Help us. Help our tribe. Help our brothers. Help our sisters. Is there anybody here today that needs to leave the orphan life and become a child? Anybody here today needs to become a child of God? Be born again in the Spirit? You get born in the flesh and that's it, you're going to die twice. But if you get born twice, you're only going to die once. Nobody? Michael, you done it. You're already born again, brother. Mama, leave him alone. Touch your daughter. For real. Let's get free, y'all. Who wants to be free? Thank you. Who wants to walk in freedom? Who wants to walk in freedom and shine bright so that others can see it, so that they can get free? It's time, y'all. In Jesus' name. And everybody that agreed says,
amen.
Yes. Father, thank you for our food. Thank you for our needs list. Thank you for our tribe. Thank you for this word today. Thank you for our visitors. We thank you for this ground that we're standing on, the breath in our lungs, the sound system that worked today, my husband that's going to be healed when I get home, all of the folks that have come out of darkness into the light that are leading the way as Timothy's in our tribe. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Give them a beat. Amen.
Amen.
I love you guys.
Wait, okay.